Everybody ready for the Mind Dog, the magnificent show?
And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here. As always, welcome to my therapy session. How are you? My guest tonight has written a book with that in the title. She's a psychotherapist, a professional. Unlike the other people who help me get through life daily on this program and act as surrogate therapist. How am I? I'm messed up, man. But I'm not sure it's attributable to the podcast, to the pandemic podcast, because I think I was pretty messed up before the pandemic. And listen, I've seen a lot of tragedy with the pandemic, and the stress that everybody else has been through with the pandemic. But I have a really different take on it. And I don't mean to offend anybody who suffered loss because of the pandemic, but I think in a lot of ways it's saved my life. I honestly believe that if not for the pandemic, we'd probably be at each other's throats. I saw a lot of ugliness in America and in the world pre-pandemic, and I thought there was a civil war coming. And I'm pretty certain, had it not been for the pandemic, that January 6th would have been a much uglier day than it was. I think we were on the precipice of a civil war. The reason only one side showed up was because the other side was taking care of themselves and trying to stay healthy and try to do the right thing by society. Anyway, the good doctor will talk to us about her book on how people are coping with re-entry to society post-pandemic, if it's truly over. We'll talk about all those things coming up. Before I bring her in, I need to quickly talk about my sponsors. Tonight is brought to you by audiobooksnow.com. Yes, audiobooksnow.com. Very loyal sponsor, sticking with us, even though I butcher their promo copy just about on a daily basis here. Audiobooksnow.com. You know about audiobooks. You know about the convenience of audiobooks, and you also know you can get them just about anywhere on the web. So why audiobooksnow.com? Well, the answer is simple. Price point, price point, price point. Audiobooks Now Club Pricing Plan is simply the best deal on audiobooks you'll find. It offers the savings and flexibility not found anywhere else with their Save on Everything discounts, rollovers, exclusive offers, loyalty program, incredible selection, and cancel anytime policy. It simply cannot be beat. Plus, get a free premium audiobook on select titles when you click the link that's in the description tonight. You'll start a 30-day free trial, or at least be offered to start a 30-day free trial of the club pricing plan, normally $4.99 a month. It's yours to try for 30 days, absolutely free. You're not happy at any time. You just cancel, and you won't be billed a penny. It's just that simple. And you can listen to a lot of books in 30 days with audiobooks. Now you save on every audiobook you purchase. They don't hide the true costs with gimmicky credits or any of that kind of stuff. Whether you want to save big through the club pricing plan or simply purchase everyday low prices, they offer one of the largest selections of audiobooks anywhere. You can download or stream the audiobooks through the website or free apps, and all apps include in-app purchasing. Link is in the description. Audiobooksnow.com. I do appreciate you patronizing our sponsors. Keeps us on the air. Now, we're going to talk about coping. And how are you doing? How am I doing? Therese Rosenblatt, PhD. Dr. Rosenblatt is a psychologist and psychoanalyst in a private practice in New York with more than 26 years of experience. She treats adults, adolescents, couples, families, and tonight she's here to treat a very disturbed podcast host. Dr. Rosenblatt is adjunct clinical supervisor at Yeshiva University and Pace University in New York, and will be teaching a graduate course at NYU's postdoctoral program in the next academic year. In her new book, How Are You? Connection in a Virtual Age, a therapist a pandemic and stories about coping with life, Dr. Rosenblatt provides vignettes chronicling how her patients have been handling the pandemic and all virtual therapy and dealing with the loss and loneliness of relationships with partners, parents, and children, work-life balance, all that kind of stuff, challenges with substance abuse, and reentry anxiety. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Dr. Therese Rosenblatt to the MindDog TV podcast. Dr. Rosenblatt, welcome.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm happy to be here.
It's my pleasure to have you here because I need a good therapist. You heard in the intro there, I'm not sure pandemic is responsible for how I'm doing. I'm not well. I'm not a well man. A lot of stress, a lot of anxiety, but I think there was a lot of that pre-pandemic. And As I said, I think in some ways, if not for the pandemic, things would be a lot uglier than they are right now in society. I know people are experiencing great stress and anxiety and all that kind of stuff, and I am too. But I think it would have been even worse had it not been for the pandemic. I think in a lot of ways, being isolated might have saved us from killing ourselves. So just your take on my position from a professional perspective.
Well, I think it's a very interesting take. And I'll start by saying that I don't know about the political part or, you know, the cultural part, and I'll get to that. But in terms of the more personal part, that if, you know, God forbid, you haven't lost a loved one or lost your income, I think a lot of people, and I'm going to include myself in that, have actually benefited greatly from the pandemic. And everybody who tells me that they have, and again, I'm going to include myself, you know, is always, when they say it, they're a little apologetic. They think they're the only ones. They think it's a little weird. But many people, including myself, have found it to be an opportunity to push the pause button, to reset, to reevaluate values and lifestyle choices, to do things differently in ways that, you know, when your life is just going on autopilot every day, you often can't think of ways to do things differently that are, you know, that you want to get out of. And this gave us the chance, and I keep saying this, but including myself, in terms of our culture, you know, it's interesting. Things were going in a bad direction already. I agree with you. And so the pandemic brought about, as well as utter tragedy, but on a cultural scale, it brought out some really good things, pulling together to get these vaccines out, you know, go US in terms of doing that. Bringing a man into the presidency who, whatever your political opinions are, and I'm not weighing in on that, is a very empathic man. I think we were losing the value of empathy in this country where, you know, in our culture, we mostly value facts and, you know, celebrity and money. And suddenly we were talking about empathy and we were valuing that. So, and there's more. So I think there was a lot of good. I think the bad is the way the whole vaccine debate has exacerbated the culture wars. You know, that's insane in a way, you know, that we have culture wars over, you know, scientific medical facts that could save lives.
Yeah, a big part of that is non-trust in government. And you can understand that to a certain extent with the different ways government can manipulate us and lie to us. But when it comes to basic things like, you know, what your doctor is telling you and not believing your doctor or not believing nurses that are, you know, you would hope they have your best interest at heart. Now, the word empathy, it's kind of funny because I've had several guests on who've talked about the idea of empathy, and I have one coming up next week or the week after, actually, who has written a book, and I've been reading his book about his journey. And he's a doctor who was hospitalized through a condition that started with getting a crown replaced on his tooth and ended up with pneumonia in the hospital. But a big part of the book is talking about how the care in the hospital and by medical professionals seemed to lack any empathy or true caring about their patients. It was all about, efficient care and the way we do things and like that. And I had Lee Tomlinson on a couple of weeks ago who had that same experience of being hospitalized and feeling like his professional medical care didn't even know what the word empathy meant. And so I think there's a lot of that going on. And I'm shocked to find out that people think of people in the medical profession as not, because they obviously they get into that profession because they have a great deal of empathy to start with. Just your take on, because I do think we had lost our way with that concept of empathy before the pandemic. Now, apparently you think it has been strengthened by the pandemic in some way?
Well, I mean, I think in certain sectors, or I don't know. Let me put it this way. I don't know whether empathy itself has been strengthened, but I do think that empathy as a concept and as an important factor to have in our leadership, in our leaders, even if we don't have it as a value, I think the fact that it's even come up, that you hear newscasters talk about it a lot, and I talk about it in my book, how, you know, one of President Lincoln's leading characteristics was empathy. And now we don't talk about it anymore because I think many people see it as, oh, that's sort of a soft value. That's sort of warm and fuzzy. It's not real. It's not empirical. It doesn't make money. And I do think, look, I have nothing against money. Life is a lot better when you have more of it rather than less of it. But I think that money and the bottom line and celebrity and being, you know, having good clickbait has become so important that it has superseded, you know, values of empathy. And there's another thing. I think in a culture like ours that so values individualism, and which I'm all for, but it has become so extreme at the expense of what is the effect on the group or the greater population. I think that emphasis on, you know, everybody's individual needs and so on and so forth has also kind of eroded the presence of empathy. I just think that it got talked about because of its lack. And right. I'm hoping that it becomes more of a factor in our leadership. I don't know if it will. I think President Biden does have it.
Yeah, possibly. I never know with politicians, and I never trust that, and I'm not a part of either party, and I'm not partisan in any way. Do think he has good intentions.
Well, I think that's well put.
Yeah. I think the political landscape is so dirtied up by partisanship and people who have the wrong agenda that even a man with the purest of intentions it would have a tough time delivering that kind of stuff. But that's a whole other thing. Yeah. Now, I mentioned in your intro that you deal with a lot of clients, patients. I don't know if you call them patients. The people who you deal with and help range from adolescents to, you know, they run the gamut.
To people in their 70s and everything in between.
Right. Has your practice seen more people coming to you stressed out, more people seeking help because of the pandemic or in the time of the pandemic than beforehand?
Yeah. So look, I mean, just keep in mind that by the time somebody comes to see me,
right,
they're pretty upset about something. People don't go to therapists lightly, even though so many people do go to therapists. And I also want to say, and I'll get to what's happening in the pandemic, that, you know, life is hard. Life is hard. And if it hasn't become hard for you when you're young, it will as you get older. So people get stressed out, right? Because life is stressful. So by the time they come to me, they're stressed out. Now, that said, I would say that I do think people are generally on balance. I have found to be more stressed out by the pandemic. And I catalog in my book, what is it that people were dealing with and stressed out about in the pandemic? And the way I could tell is not what was happening in the sessions as much, because as I said, people share their depression and anxiety with me anyway, but you know, the referrals were just overwhelming, you know, there, and I know that's been written about. So many people, you know, who weren't in therapy were feeling the need for them. Now, with the pandemic, I feel like it was split. I feel like among my patient population, there were a bunch that definitely, you know, have been very anxious throughout the pandemic. And I would say in some ways, even more now with reentry. And then other people, as you said in the beginning of your broadcast, other people have found it to be an opportunity. And I write about that, that it has been a tremendous opportunity for those who are lucky enough not to have major losses.
Right. And not only that, I think not just an opportunity, I think some people needed a timeout. Needed a timeout of just from the rat race, from the traffic every day, whatever it was that was adding to their stress. A lot of people were on edge. And, you know, let's face it, and I don't want to make this a political show, but the country was definitely on edge. And we saw that culminating with January 6th. But the tensions in the country were high enough anyway. So I think in some sense, that timeout, the time that you can't leave home, get used to it. It kind of was a settling catalyst for people in a way that, okay, I know things are out of my control, but there's nothing I can do about them. And sometimes that surrender can be a way to find some peace and relieve some anxiety. Am I wrong in that?
Absolutely. And like I said, people did say that to me, again, thinking they were the only one. It was my experience as well. I have two practices, one in New York City in Manhattan and the other one in Westchester in Scarsdale. And I also have a home in each place. And so my life was constantly running between the two offices and the two homes. It worked. Everything worked very smoothly, but it was taking its toll on me. It was frenetic. I was never, you know, in one place long enough. And the pandemic gave me the opportunity not only to be in one place all the time and feel, it felt very consolidating. It felt very peaceful. I was able to have more self-care, eliminating the commutes. But it also has helped me to figure out as I re-enter how I'm going to reorganize my life, because I couldn't figure out how to do it beforehand. And this really helped me do it. So yes, I agree with you. And which is why I'm finding, I think, heightened anxiety as people are having to deal with the ambiguity of reentry. You know, how safe are we? Aren't we? Are we going back into the office? Are we not? Is it hybrid? You know, when it was shelter in place, okay, we had to deal with losses, but we had no decisions to make. We needed to save our lives by not going out. And that's that surrender that you were talking about that I think made many people feel, you know, maybe they didn't want the pandemic to stick around, but there was a kind of peace and surrender to it.
Yeah, I've heard some people actually say, I missed the pandemic. I missed lockdown. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah.
Very strange times we live in. But before we get off the medical, I'm married to a nurse. And my friend Craig is also married to a nurse, and he's in one of the chat rooms right now, and he has this question. Ask about nurses and PTSD. My poor wife is anxious as hell after doing nothing but COVID since it kicked off. My wife, too, and I talked about, and we both talked about lack of empathy, but I talked about it in the medical field. But there are some nurses and doctors who actually are still connected to what drove them to be doctors and nurses in the first place. And those people have been worked to death and pushed to the breaking point and continue to be pushed to the breaking point. So to Craig's point, are you seeing a rise in, or maybe not, maybe they're so overwhelmed that they're not even seeking help, but have you seen any kind of rise in those people who are just really in need of help? I'm talking about medical professionals, nurses, and doctors.
You know, I don't have a great deal of medical personnel in my practice, but I do have a few, and they were really, really overwhelmed. Again, I'm in New York. They were really, really overwhelmed at the beginning of the pandemic when New York was especially hit hard, and they were reeling. They seem to be better now, but they really are living through, you know, in a way, I mean, you might know this as well as I, since you live with a nurse, the definition of trauma. I mean, trauma is when you either go through yourself or you witness a life-threatening event. You feel helpless, powerless, fragmented. And so for the medical personnel, I think this was really a traumatic event.
Right.
Like trauma victims, most of them did what they had to do to go through it because that's what you do. But when you're doing that, you don't, in a traumatic situation, you don't get to process what's going on. So afterwards, the trauma can linger and you wind up with PTSD. And certainly for them, this was a traumatic event.
Right. I want to show the book while we continue to talk. This is the book here. It's called How Are You? Connection in a Virtual Age, A Therapist, A Pandemic, and Stories About Coping with Life. Now, and I know you're probably going to say, yes, it's just as beneficial and all that. So I'm assuming you're probably going to say that. But the dynamic of what you do this way, as opposed to me laying on your couch or sitting on your sofa, or however it might have taken place pre-pandemic, is it the same?
Is it the same?
Is it the same that you'll be able to get therapy remotely, virtually like this, as opposed to me being in your office, being a little more intimate and comfortable in that? Because, you know, this is not a natural way to communicate. no matter how we push it, it's just not natural for people to communicate this way.
I actually write extensively about that in the book. And the answer to that is it is both the same and different. So, sorry. There are definitely losses. And I write about the fact that, you know, in addition to the things we know we've lost, You're not in my office. We're missing just all those physical cues from each other. There's also a different kind of intimacy of, you know, our faces are right next to each other, screen to screen. Or I have a lot of patients who prefer just the phone with no visual, and I have their voices snug in my ear. And the big shock to me was that even with the losses of not being in the same physical space, how rich and productive a lot of the therapy was. Now, that said, what I found absolutely fascinating is I was kind of cataloging some of the things that we were missing in person, was I started to notice things that people don't talk about, all the things in our unconscious that we pick up from one another, like hormones, like the information we get from smell. And I list a whole bunch of these things that you don't normally think about, but that are giving you and I information about each other while we're physically in the same room. And that's a loss. On the other hand, I also write about the fact that, you know, the key to success in life, and I don't mean necessarily professional success, but being a successful person, is adaptation. And the virtual age is here to stay. And so while certain people were sort of you know, moaning about what we've lost by, you know, doing therapy, you know, virtually all the time. And I'm not for only working virtually. I'm absolutely for getting back to the office part-time, but we have to adapt to where the world is now. And so I've been, you know, thinking about and observing all these ways that I practice differently to make the virtual work. And many people love it. Many people love that they don't have to leave their home, that they can meet with me from anywhere. If they go on a trip or if they're a little under the weather, we can still meet. And but it has necessitated certain changes in the way I interact with people.
Yeah, I would imagine it would. And being what you do, I mean, communication is more than just verbal, right? So I can sit here and tell you stuff, but you're not really getting the full experience of my communication because you're only seeing my body language from here up, and you're not really experiencing. So in your profession, and I don't have to tell you this, but this is for the audience's benefit more than anything, is that sometimes people will tell you stuff that is not necessarily true, trying to please the therapist and all that kind of stuff, or tell you what they think you want to hear. And your skill and part of your training is to see through that bullshit but by noticing whether they're congruent, body language, all that kind of stuff. And so I think some of that must get lost. No, am I wrong in assuming that?
Again, certainly some of it does. And, you know, the toughest thing is we don't know what we're missing. We don't know what we're not getting.
Right.
I don't know what your feet are doing right now and what they might be telling me. I don't know what, if I didn't see you in my waiting room, you know, how you were sitting, what you were doing in the waiting room. I don't know what I'm missing from that. I am losing that information. And I don't minimize that at all. I think that's really important. On the other hand, we need to learn how to work remotely as well. And there's other information that I do get when we do work remotely. There's certain people that have told me that if it weren't for the pandemic and working remotely, there's certain things they wouldn't have told me. You know, you do have to sharpen other channels of, you know, sort of receptive listening and looking and learning. I see people in habitats that I wouldn't normally see them in.
Right.
Something. So look, I mean, if I could design the ideal therapy, yes, it would be in person. There's no doubt about it. But there is, you know, let's say somebody is listening now and they're considering seeing a therapist and they're not sure if they're going to get enough out of it virtually. I would say if you go to the right person and you're willing to, you know, to put in the effort, you will and you can. You know, in other words, you know that expression, don't let the best be the enemy of the good.
Yeah, yeah. Well, as I'm listening to you, I'm thinking of things that you could probably, if you're good at what you do, pick up on that you would not have access to if they came and they're just sitting in your office and you're just seeing them in that environment. In other words, if somebody, and somebody might not even confess this to you in traditional therapy, if somebody is a pack rat or a hoarder or whatever you want to use the word for it, you're seeing them in their home all of a sudden, wow, that's a light bulb that into their personality and what might be troubling them that they wouldn't even talk to me about. And I would not know if I had not this window into their real environment and who they really are. So in some ways that must be very helpful, no?
It can be for sure. I personally find the most helpful thing about remote therapy is the way in which people feel very comfortable coming to therapy. They don't have to leave their house. They're not racing. They're not irritable from the traffic. They're comfortable in their homes. Our faces are, you know, they're not literally a few inches from each other on the phone. And like I said, I was fascinated to see that a lot of people my ongoing patients who I didn't first meet during the pandemic opted to meet with me on the phone, and a number of them spoke about things that they were having trouble talking to me about in the office because of that little bit of, you know, camouflage and distance. Again, I always think people together is better, but, and the other thing is I've adapted. So I think I'm a little more animated. I talk a little more. I even disclose a little bit more, not a lot, but a little more, because I feel like I need to bridge that gap between the two machines. And I think that helps to sort of make people feel comfortable and, you know, open them up.
For somebody who has no experience in psychotherapy or any kind of counseling like this, what do you think is one of the biggest misconceptions about what to expect in a relationship with a therapist?
Let me see. I think that people feel, I think some people are afraid that they'll feel under a microscope and dissected. If you're a good therapist, you don't act that way. You really take your lead from the patient. I think people think that somehow the therapist is not a regular person and they're going to be, you know, like the old fashioned caricature, hardly talk, be very remote. So I try to be very real, and I try to let people know if they're feeling worried about that. Hey, we're just two people sitting in a room talking about your life. I'm trained in how to guide you through certain challenges, and the you know, you are the focus. You get my full undivided attention, and we listen to you. But we're just two human beings sitting in a room, and I'm trying to help you.
Right. In terms of the book and vignettes in the book, now I'm sure you've gone, you've been very careful not to breach any patient confidentiality and all that kind of stuff. But does that change the dynamic for people you work with, knowing you wrote a book, and am I somehow in there and a little bit nervous about you maybe even talking about my situation, even without naming me, just what I'm going through? Is there any kind of
That's a great question, and that is a huge theoretical and ethical issue in our field. So I went to extraordinary lengths to disguise people, probably more than I had to, but I really wanted to protect them. And then I asked, you know, I spoke to people about whether I could, you know, write about them. And I've been listening very attentively to any changes or effects, and I'm assuming I don't know them all yet because the book is just coming out. But my experience so far, since I've had those discussions with the people that I wrote about, is that it deepened the work, that it, just like seeing them in their own home, that the idea of my writing about them and what I wrote about gave opportunities to talk about things that wouldn't have come up, and just really deepen the work. And I like to think that they felt respected in the way I handled it. I was very respectful, and I let them know that I would not use the material if they didn't want me to.
Right. Now, I'm wondering, because I know, I don't know. I'm assuming that people have sought out therapy more during the pandemic, but I also know a lot of negative behaviors have increased in a huge way. Alcoholism, substance abuse, well, alcoholism is substance abuse, so we can lump them together, but some substance abuse, you know, the use of pornography has gone through the roof, according to numbers. All those kind of really negative behaviors have creeped in. Are those things that do they have an effect on the therapy? So if I'm going to you for therapy, right, and I'm doing this from my home, and the minute we get off this call, I'm going to go pick up a bottle or go smoke a joint or whatever I'm going to do. Does that work against, does that negate the therapy that we just spent an hour or however long your sessions are?
Yeah, I don't know whether it negates it fully, but it does not help. I mean, first of all, if somebody is coming to session, and I had one patient who actually was drinking wine during the session, and they're under the influence, even lightly, I mean, you know what that does to you. You're not being completely you. And I want to see the real you, even with your inhibitions and your defenses, and even if you're feeling inhibited and that drink opens you up, I want to see that you're feeling inhibited, and I want to work with what are you afraid of and why. And I don't get to do that if you're drinking. So, and if you're drinking right afterwards, not during, you're, you know, everybody I've ever spoken to, you know, if they're drinking other than to party, they're drinking to numb. So, yeah, I mean, if you're going to numb everything that we just, you know, opened up, it's not a help.
Right.
On the other hand, then I would want to, if they were able to talk to me about it, as many of my patients have, then we get to talk about the what and the why and the how of the problem, and I can hopefully help them with that.
Right. I ask because I know people who are in therapy who if you asked me to describe them, I would say they were an alcoholic. They don't necessarily describe themselves that way, but I know they drink every day, get drunk every day, but still are in therapy. And I just wonder, like, you know, how that can possibly be productive and still maintain that life of, you know, just being trashed every day, drunk every day, drinking every day without missing a day ever. Basically, and that's part of the plan. And it got worse during the pandemic.
Let me also say this to that. I mean, first of all, yeah, I agree with you, and you know, we both just laid out why that's not helpful. That said, if the person actually wants to be in therapy and isn't just checking the box, but wants to be there, better that they be in therapy and they're drinking, and we can try to work on it, than not be in therapy at all. Because the first thing I want to do with somebody that has a substance use problem is I want to do a lot of work with them around why and what they're getting out of it. Because otherwise you just get a dry alcoholic or drug addict or whatever.
Right. When I met my wife, we both, and we were very honest about this, we were looking for somebody to fix me. She was looking for me to fix her, and I was looking for her to fix me. Do people expect that of you? You're going to fix me, and this is going to be a short-term thing. I'm just here for a cure, quote-unquote cure. I'm coming to see you expecting to get fixed, you know, healed, whatever you want to put on it, and it's not going to be an ongoing process, or it really isn't about digging deep into me. It's going to find the single key to happiness, and you're gonna fix me and give me the answer to why I'm not miserable.
Yeah, I certainly get some of those people. I think that the people who stay with me are the people who are serious about trying to look at themselves and make changes. The ones who just want to be fixed and, you know, I call it follow these five easy steps, or, you know, flick a switch, or, you know, something like that, I think they wind up not staying, because they'd be disappointed or frustrated when they see that more is involved. And B, I'm not the kind of therapist that will just sort of say pablum. I'm there to work. I want to help people change in the ways they want. And so people probably pick that up from me fairly quickly.
Yeah. You know, because of what I do, I interview a lot of authors who, how can I put this in a respectful way, put out books that do offer quick fixes to life, five easy steps to fix whatever it is, that three easy steps, whatever it is. And I'm usually a lot more combatant, argumentative with those folks, because I think that's a negative idea to put in people's heads. So that being said, the purpose behind your book is to encourage people to get into more into therapy, or is it just to explain what you've observed during? What is the purpose?
That's a great question. And I became very interested in that myself, because the moment the pandemic hit and lockdown, and I had to move to all remote therapy, because I had always done some, if somebody, you know, was traveling occasionally or whatever, I became fascinated by what was going on and by my observations of my patients, myself, how we were being, our challenge, what we were facing, how the therapy was being affected, because there's no, I study a lot of theory and technique. There's no theory and technique for this, so I was sort of making it up as I went along, so in terms of the remote work. So I became fascinated by that. And so a lot of it was noting those observations, was writing about how this was changing the very nature of therapy and our world, that therapy in a way is just a microcosm of our world because it's a very human endeavor. But then I realized I had always wanted to write for the general public to tell them about the kind of therapy I do, which is analytic therapy, which listens to the unconscious and how the unconscious influences our behavior. And I had always wanted to tell people about it to make it more approachable, less mysterious, and basically to tell people how wonderful it was. I mean, when you were talking about people who have, like stereotypes about therapy or anxious about it, some of that was to, in a way, not to even just explain, but to show. Like through a lot of these stories, and then I did some little bit of explaining some of the dynamics and techniques in a very, very plain English, user-friendly way. I wanted to show people what a deep, human, rich, rewarding experience and relationship this could be. So I'm a professional, but I'm a human first. And that's the way I approach my patients.
Well, so, I appreciate that. And I think that's a good reason to write the book rather than because I know I always am conflicted about the people who write the quick, you know, three steps or whatever it is, those quick cure books about, you know, this is the easy road to success. I think, first of all, it sets people up for disappointment and failure, because I don't think there is any quick fix for human beings. And so you get a book like that, you're expecting, well, all I have to do is read this book and my life is going to change. And then it doesn't. And then you sour on all kinds of information that could be self-help stuff or looking to improve yourself. But I also think that at some point, when you're writing a book like that, it's for self-grandization. It's like, you know what, I'm going to build myself up as the guru for this program of help. And stuff. So
That's not me. I wrote it. Another reason I wrote it is, although I certainly talk to my patients, otherwise they wouldn't get anything out of the therapy, but I do a lot more listening than talking. And I certainly don't impose my values or opinions on them. I mean, I tell them what I think therapeutically, and I wanted to express myself. I had a lot to say. Right. And so I said a lot in this book, which I couldn't necessarily say in, you know, in my work.
Yeah, I get that. I can relate to that 100%. I mean, just basically why I started the podcast. I have a lot to say and I have a lot to learn. And basically that's part of my mission here too. And I do tend to make this about myself. And even though I think through me, the audience can probably see something that they can gain from it. So I have a question that is very personal, but I think at the root of all the stress and anxiety for me personally, but I'm betting there are a lot of people out there who are like me, that when we're experiencing stress and anxiety, and what's not perfect in our lives, a lot of it, I know in my case, is true, is comparing self to others. And saying, well, you know what, looking at my life through a microscope and all constantly saying, well, look at so-and-so, they're more successful in this area. Look at this person, they're more successful in that. And beating myself up over that. Is that a very common experience with people who are seeking enlightenment or insight into their own personality and happiness?
Sure. That's huge. And especially, you know, living in the New York area, New York City area, that is teeming with, you know, incredibly high achieving people. It absolutely abounds in this area, but it's everywhere, because a very big facet of human behavior is to beat up on ourselves and to compare ourselves. That is part of being a human being. And a small amount of it is healthy and normal, but too much of it is crippling. And so a lot of people cripple themselves that way. And yeah, it's a big problem.
Right. Beyond just saying, well, don't beat up on yourself. Don't be so hard on yourself. I'm not looking for a quick explanation on what the cure is for that, but how do you approach people who or deal with people who are chronically obsessed with comparing themselves to others and beating and being and I'm guessing the word I'm looking for is self-empathy, and can self-empathy be taught or encouraged in any way?
Well, that's also a great question, because I think that's one of the things that you hope the patients like what you're describing, who are very hard on themselves, that is one of the goals of therapy. And it doesn't happen by you simply telling the person, you know, oh, stop beating up on yourself. It happens through a complicated mix of first identifying it. I mean, believe it or not, most people aren't even aware when they're doing that. You might be, and some people are, but many people aren't. So first identify it, and you know, you'll sort of see people go, oh, you know, they didn't even, you know, like, oh yeah, like they didn't even realize it. You know, you try to understand the sources of it. As humans, we have a lot of voices in our head, non-psychotic voices, just our, you know, our thoughts that we've borrowed from, you know, the caregivers and important grown-up figures in our life from when we were a child. And often we exaggerate, you know, how hard they are on us, but not always an exaggeration. But we think, you know, they may want us, you know, to be here. We think they want us here. Or sometimes they do. And sometimes they are very hard on us, and or very punishing. And we internalize that, we take that in. So you try to unpack all of that. And in, you know, and this is where it's so important that we as therapists not judge, that we try to teach the patient, hey, we're looking at this together, non-judgmentally, and we're trying to understand it. And you, you know, little by little, you hope that they start to internalize that experience in joining you on just kind of looking at this stuff, looking at yourself without being so judgmental.
Right. On that subject, though, I always wonder if I'm doing more harm than good because my motif, I guess, for dealing with that kind of stuff, because I talk to so many people who have written about self-help and people who are life coaches and this kind of stuff. The only reason I'm aware that I beat myself up mentally so is because I talk to so many people who point out exactly how I am. But I think part of my mission, and it could be, I could be doing more harm than good when I think about it, is kind of show that we're all human. We're all have faults, and you know, everybody has something they hold in shame or regret doing, and no matter how strong you are. And I know some people won't admit, oh, I have nothing, I regret. And I think that's bullshit as well. I think every single one of us has things we'd rather not let the world know about that we have done. And I like to kind of point out that we all have that. Now, I'm not sure if that's a positive way to kind of frame it for people, because I think that might, it's just, I'm just trying to get your opinion on this, whether that is a positive thing, because I think it might put people in the give up mode. Well, if we're all just screwed up, then I just might as well go with whatever mental illness I'm dealing with, or stress, or what anxiety and all that kind of stuff, because there's no cure for it. And I'm just wondering if exposing it and pointing out that everybody has something they're not proud of, regret, whatever you want to, whatever kind of language you want to use, is that necessarily a good thing or a bad thing, or it's really subjective to the person?
Well, yeah, I mean, to your point, I think, you know, how are people going to react to it? I think for most things in life, you know, you're going to get, half the people are going to find that relieving, and maybe there'll be a bunch that will say, all right, well, why try anyway? But I think maybe the if you want to transmit that, which I think is a really good mission, is to show it, you know, rather than just say it. And this is something that comes up in parenting a lot, where, you know, your kid is going through something very difficult, you know, they failed at something or did badly, or you know, got rejected from somebody, you know, sharing in the right moments. You don't want to overshare, but like, the right time and the right moment to say to your kid, you know, I remember when this or that happened to me, and it felt horrible, and this is how I dealt with it. You know, that showing that kind of humility, I think, sends that message that you're trying to send.
Yeah, I'm definitely guilty of oversharing. I'm what is known as a blabbermouth. I've said things on the air and gotten phone calls about it, and like, wow, you can't talk about that stuff. I mean, very deep scars from my childhood and from my upbringing that I share freely without thinking about the repercussions not only in my life but other people's lives too. So I'm very aware of trying to curb that or think about what comes out of my mouth
more. But you know what, some people probably love it, and some people probably feel really comfortable with you because of it. And by the way, I in an earlier life, I used to be a live talk radio producer. And it's people like you who speak so easily and don't hide a lot that are really good on air.
Yeah, I happen to agree. And speaking of that, I wanted to talk to you about this because, and I don't know if it's pertinent to this conversation at all, but Howard Stern wrote a book, Howard Stern Comes Again. But in that book, he details his how therapy changed his life. And he highly recommends it for so many people, and he does seem like a changed person. I mean, from the shock jock that he was when in the 80s and 90s when I got fired from a station for being a Howard Stern wannabe at one point. But so I think it has changed his life. But he talks about in his book how he felt the need to entertain or make stuff up or try to tell stories to a therapist to keep their attention, to keep them entertained. Like, my life is too boring to just talk about what's really bothering me, so I'm going to, you know, exaggerate things and tell stories and stuff like that. Is that a common thing among people when they first come to therapy, is this idea of, I'm a boring person. I really don't have much to talk about. There's nothing really special about my life or who I am.
I'll answer you, but I'm smiling because I was going to bring up the Howard Stern book, which I've read. Okay. And he was extolling the virtues of the kind of therapy that I practice, which is psychoanalytic therapy, which is the therapy that doesn't give a quick fix, but that is deeply human and rich in kind of helping you go on your own personal journey of understanding yourself your circumstances and how they influenced you. And it I think it did change him. But and I remember I think it was in his first session that the therapist said, you know, why are you always joking? And that was like life changing for him. There are always a bunch of people who feel that way. I wouldn't say it's everyone, but there are always a bunch of people who feel that way. And, you know, it's an interesting task to try to show them that, well, first of all, therapy is not about entertaining your therapist. Secondly, I'll quote what a professor in grad school said, which I wholeheartedly agree with. He said, people's emotional lives are intrinsically interesting. So if you can get somebody to free themselves of only talking about the factual events of their life, which, you know, we need some of that, and to really tell us about what's going on inside, that is endlessly fascinating. But also, what you hope is to get the patient fascinated in themselves, not in a narcissistic way, but in a way of like, wow, I did that. I'm this way. I wonder why, what made me do that? You know, why do I keep doing that to myself? And that is intrinsically interesting.
Yeah, I agree. I definitely agree. And for me, I know I would probably have that initial, you know, I have been in therapy. I'm not in therapy at the moment, but I know my initial approach to it was pretty much the same as Howard Stern's, in that I'm doing a show here. I'm here to entertain the therapist. And it took me a while to figure out, you know what, this isn't getting it. It's not serving my need. I'm still walking out of here feeling exactly what I felt when I walked in, and that's not what.
Interesting. So you felt like you weren't. It was like sort of hiding you.
Right. I'm paying them when they should be paying me. If all I'm doing is a show, I mean, you pay the admission and come to see my show. I don't have to come to your office to do your show and pay you. That doesn't make sense. So if I'm going to get anything out of it for myself, if I'm going to start feeling better about myself, I got to start being honest about who and what I am and what's really bothering me. And that is a difficult thing for some people.
Yeah. And also, I think, you know, another goal of therapy is to give you more of a sense of choice and control over the things that you can control. So if you can come to a point where in certain circumstances you drop the entertainment shtick and you just, you know, are relating to somebody in a more sincere way, you know, and then are able to say, okay, now I'm on air. Now I'm going to be the entertainer. And this way you have more control. It's not so automatic. That's a good place to be.
Dig it. Well, thank you for that. We are coming up on the hour. Is it okay if we just go a little bit over the hour? Because there's some more I want to talk to you about. Earlier in this conversation, you talked about how younger people in particular are struggling with this. And as an older person, I think about that all the time, because there is nothing in my life that I can relate to. I mean, we've seen a lot of different, you know, John F. Kennedy getting killed, John Lennon getting killed, you know, Reagan almost assassinated, all those, and, you know, 9/11, all those kind of traumatic things, nothing remotely relatable to the pandemic and lockdown and having the prime of your life when you're in those years where days feel like years and everything is so important. Every little task you do feels like it's your life is riding on it when you're a young person. I can't relate to those. So in the spirit of empathy, I think about what it must be like to be a young person and have this moment in your life, which has lasted far longer than most would ever, you know, feel. 18 months is an eternity for a 20-year-old or a 16-year-old. So with those in general, have we seen First of all, those people coming to you and seeking out therapy more, are they turning to help, or are they turning more inside and just feeling defeated, and you're seeing less of those people actually come out and try to seek, you know, some help?
Yeah, no, I think lots and lots of them are seeking therapy. I have I work a lot with younger people. I have a lot of patients that I see who are in college in their 20s, and they seem to be seeking therapy in droves. I think a lot of it is pandemic driven. I think a lot of it is some of the variables that you mentioned that were pre-pandemic about our world that is very difficult to live in, right. You know, even before, but I absolutely think they have suffered, an inordinate amount in the pandemic. And the fascinating thing that's happening now is I'm still working remotely. I'm hoping in the fall, if there isn't a new surge, to, you know, at least initiate some kind of at least partial reentry into my office. Most referrals I get understand and are fine with working remotely now. However, in the last few months, I've gotten a number of referrals from very young people, Gen Zers, age 20, whatever, who only want to see somebody in person, which fascinates me. I mean, this is the computer generation. I mean, they...
Right. You would think they'd be more comfortable with this
exactly.
than I would.
And in a way, I find it very moving that they really need that personal contact. I also find it kind of encouraging that, you know, these are the kids that they can't make, they're afraid to call somebody on the phone because they only text, and yet they want to see somebody in person for this very human kind of work. But I do, and the other thing is, in their generation, it seems to be much more acceptable to talk about therapy. They seem to all talk about their therapist, and hey, my friend needs a therapist.
They seem to be more willing to talk about just about anything. But and I hate to sound like I hate to even make any judgments about them, because I hated it when I was young and old people would make judgments about my generation. I wanted to get your take. You said encouraging. Are you an optimist? Because I'm going to ask if you're an optimist, but the reason I'm asking if you're an optimist is because I can't imagine being a young person and dealing with all the stresses and all the garbage that, and it's hard to, again, I'm thinking back to my youth. We had things, but we didn't have things like today's generation have to kind of be pessimistic about the world we live in and just really have a tough time adjusting to it and adapting, as you, the word you used before. Are you an optimist for the future?
The future of our youth, or just
yeah. Well, of course, because the future of our youth, but of course, they are the old people of tomorrow, and they will be running things. And so, if they are mentally broken in some way by the time they get to the position of power that my generation has now, the world is not going to be in a very good place. We need those people to be healthy. So when I say, are you an optimist? Yes, I'm talking about the youth, but eventually they will be running the world. And so I'm talking about the world in general.
Right. Well, I consider myself a realist, and occasionally somebody thinks that my realism is pessimism. It's not. There's a phrase that I use. It's reality is your friend. We don't know how to cope with something if we can't confront the reality of it. So, but what I observe in my own behavior is there's a kind of hopefulness in me and seeing the positive side sometimes. And so with the youth, they move me. A lot of them are really... they're very disturbed with things that are going on, and good for them that they are, and that they want to do things differently. And I have kids that, I mean, I call them kids, they're not, but compared to me, who are really thoughtful and really want to do things right. And, you know, that's encouraging.
Right. Has the pandemic been a more traumatic for them, or has it been more traumatic for maybe it's subjective and each individual, but for generations, again, my generation had nothing to compare this to, and I know a lot of people were traumatized, but not in a I'm in shock and I can't move deer in the headlights kind of way. A lot of them were angry about it. You know, a lot of older people got really angry about it, like the world is doing this to me, and adopted that attitude. Has there been a generational divide among how people are adapting to it or reacting to the pandemic from
you? So in my experience, And let me preface this by saying, you know, and especially in the way I'm trained and in my work, the answer is when it comes to human beings and what you see in them and how you respond to them in the work I do, it's always, it depends. But that said, to the extent that I could generalize and put people in groups, my observations have been that it's been much harder on the younger people. The older people that I tend to talk to, and it's not like it's been easy for them, but you know, many of them have built their lives by, you know, the time they're middle age or a little older. If they're going to have a partner, they have their partner. A lot of them have kids. If they don't have that, they've built another kind of life. And a lot of them are the ones that have welcomed the sort of the time out. And, you know, they haven't, they either have family and friends around, or if they don't, a lot of them are more okay spending more time alone. The younger people, as you said, as you pointed out, they are in the stage of life where they're outward turning. They're out looking for mates. They're, right. You know, they're out, I'm saying that in a biological way, because they may think they're just trying to have fun, but that behavior, you know, from an evolutionary point of view, is really about finding a mate and procreating, and they're building their careers. Their apartments and their homes are too small, you know, so they're stuck in these small spaces, and a lot of them are lonely. They didn't have a partner, you know, it's hard to date, and they just felt a lot of despair, I found.
Right. I can't imagine, you know, if I think back now, being locked in the house with my parents when I was a teenager, first of all, I came from a very dysfunctional home where I felt like I had to run away at 14 and take care of myself at 14 years old. So, but if I was one of those kids who was in a tough house to begin with, and being locked in with them, I think that would have really, I don't know if I would have survived it, to be honest.
Yes. I mean, that's hopefully an extraordinary situation, although you're not alone in it. And I even worked with somebody in that situation, and that would be kind of a nightmare. And even the young people who I work with who come from, you know, hopefully warmer homes where the parents at least trying to be supportive, but their whole process of sort of separation, individuation, becoming their own person was derailed. And that's a lot of the work that I've been doing with them, is how do you kind of preserve yourself and become your own person when you're stuck at home with your parents who are telling you what to do and you have no privacy?
Right. I want to end, we're just getting way off topic here, and it's all about me, of course, and then we'll come back to the book before we close up tonight. But I was thinking about this on the subject of parenting and thinking about myself, and as I disclosed to you earlier, I tend to beat up on myself, thinking why I'm not the person I want to be, and we have a tendency to blame our parents. My parents weren't good parents, but I don't blame them. And I was thinking about this idea of forgiving our parents, because so many parents don't know. You don't know. There's no book on how to be a good parent. And if most of them wouldn't have read it anyway, I know I wouldn't have read it. I know I wasn't a good parent. So it's ridiculous for me to be angry at my parents for the way I turned out. But if I'm honest with myself, they weren't good parents at all. I mean, I wasn't taught a lot of things that a young man needs to be taught and all that kind of stuff. So I wonder if you could just talk about this idea of, because I think it's chronic. I think a lot, we've reached a point where every time we get to a stage in our adult life where we look at ourselves and aren't happy with what the results we produced for ourselves, we tend to blame our parents. And even if our parents were very bad parents, in my case, I think they were trying to be good parents. They just didn't know how to. So I'm just want to know if you can talk a little bit about this idea of not holding your parents accountable for who you are and having some sort of some degree of forgiveness and empathy with what they went through.
Look, I think forgiveness is fantastic if you can get there. But and empathy certainly always helps, especially towards one's parents. But I think one of the difficulties I have with certain philosophies is that they rush people towards empathy and forgiveness for the people who've wronged them. And that's a process that you have to come to in your own pace, in your own time. It can't be rushed and it can't be forced. And there are also certain things that can't be forgiven. And that's not for me to decide. That's for you or any other individual to decide. And you may need to start by understanding what went wrong and then ultimately take responsibility for yourself, because right. No matter what was done to you, no one is going to change you but yourself. So, you know, if you can, you need to go on that journey in order to get there.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And that's kind of where, you know, I agree that there are some things that can't be forgiven. Some things were, but I think, if you look at the intent, I don't think most parents, I think this is true of the majority of people who are parents, don't go into it with intention of being a bad parent.
No, when I really learned that in the very beginning of my career, I worked in a program that worked to reunite parents with their children that they had lost to foster care. And so we'd work to reunite the two. And so there was a lot of intensive work with the parents and with the kids. And in order to lose a child to foster care, you have to have done something really bad. The state does not take your children away easily at all. And what I learned from it, and, you know, these people were parents who I worked with were drug addicts, and they had abused their kids and they had severely neglected them. And what I learned was that in the majority of cases, not all, but the majority, they didn't do it on purpose. They still loved their kids in their own way. They just couldn't cut it.
Right.
And that was a really and that doesn't excuse the neglect and the abuse, but it was a fascinating insight into, they didn't wish it that way. They didn't will it that way. They wished that they weren't like that.
Right. Can I ask you one more question before we wrap this up? This is kind of heavy, and I'm sure it has nothing to do with why you wrote the book, but for me, it's something I think about all the time, and I would love to get a psychotherapist's perspective on it. And it's about good and evil and human nature. And because, and I ask this of a lot of people who kind of know the mind, and I'm curious as your opinion on it. Are people, is good and evil born into us? Are people born good and evil, or is it something that we adopt through environment, behavior, and all that kind of stuff, and the way the world treats us and the way we react to it? Just kind of the nature of good and evil from a psychotherapist's perspective.
Man, oh man, that's like a God question.
It is like a God question.
I don't know whether I can answer that, but I'll take a try, okay?
Okay.
I don't know whether people are born good or evil. And I do think that a lot of that depends on your environmental influences. What I would say is that some people, I think, are born with more natural empathy and need to nurture and help. Or the way I think of it is, some people are more love oriented. You know, you listen to people talk and you hear them, they're always pushing for a more loving connection. They want things to be nice. They're usually people that want to please others, that do have a lot of empathy. And I think a lot of that is inborn, and it takes a lot to stamp that out. There are people who are born with, they're not oriented that way. You know, they're more disconnected. They don't have as much of a sense of the other person. But I think to turn that kind of, or they're, you know, they're tough, they're rigid, they're just difficult to deal with. They don't seem to want to make the relation, they're not relationship oriented. They're not there. Like, you know, you'll know some people are always looking for common ground in a relationship, and then there are the others that they don't really care about that. And I think a lot of that is inborn. For that to actually turn into evil, though, I think has to come from that kind of person being put in a really cold, hard environment. I don't think anybody's born evil. They're born with a more difficult temperament that might really need more understanding and nurturing in order to develop into a really good person, you know, loving person. Right. But outright evil, I don't know.
I always come back to the Hitler example. Like, it just seemed like, and I hate to think people could be born evil, but it seems like that human being was destined to be evil right from the start. And that's just my where. Yes. And it's one of the things that drives me like crazy thinking about, you know, do we all have the capability of manifesting that evil within ourselves, or was he a unique individual born?
Well, look, I do think that, I don't know about all, but I do think a lot of people are born with the potential for evil, and then they have to be in an environment that brings that out.
Right.
But I don't know if you watched Mindhunter on Netflix.
Yeah, I don't have television.
this was a fascinating series about serial killers, which is normally not my interest, but it was very well done. And, you know, you did get the feeling that there was something really off about these people. Like, they had to have been born with something, but every single one of them was horribly treated from very early age. So I think the combination.
Fascinating, fascinating conversation. Now back to the book before we actually finally wrap this up. It's been a great conversation, by the way. I've really enjoyed it. The book, you said somewhere in this conversation that it just came out. It's just recently, like within a week, or how long
yesterday. Is it? Yesterday. Came out yesterday.
Yesterday. So I could not find a dedicated website for it. I think I have a link in Amazon in the description for people to see it. Is there a dedicated website for it?
There's an Amazon link, and I think now if you just plug in, I don't know when you were looking, but if you plug in the title, how are you, connection in a virtual age, a therapist, a pandemic, and stories about coping with life, and my name, Therese Rosenblatt, PhD, it should come up.
Okay. If I can find it, I will definitely put it in the link there, in the description, the link in the description.
Well,
there
is, can I send you the Amazon link somehow?
I have the Amazon link already in the description, so we're good with that one.
Yeah. Okay. Then it should come up.
And so you haven't had any time to get any real feedback from readers yet, because nobody's read the book in a day.
not the public, just kind of more personal connections. And they all seem to, you know, to really like it. And I was testing them, you know, is it just because you know me? And, you know, a lot of them really couldn't put it down. So that felt good.
Yeah, well,
to make sure. So you felt you couldn't, like, you clicked on the Amazon link and it wouldn't.
No, I have the Amazon link. I was looking for like a dedicated page to, like, a dedicated website that some people put up for when they put out a new book. It's just a website just dedicated to that book.
Oh, I haven't done that. It's on my LinkedIn, and I haven't made.
Okay, so we'll send all people there. That not a problem. I mean, the links work. The Amazon links work. I just sometimes people prefer to go to a website so they can, I don't know, get a author signed copy, you know, direct bypass Amazon. Some people have issues with Amazon, whatever.
Oh, well, maybe I have to learn all that stuff.
Yeah. Well, I wish you great success with it. What is your hope and intent for the book? I mean, what would make you happy about the outcome here?
I think what would make me happy is if people got some takeaways about just coping with life and crises and not feeling like, oh, these bad things shouldn't happen. Right. They should and they do. And now what are you going to do about them? Like adapting. I would like it if people would learn a little bit more about talk therapy. And how incredibly, in this big, bewildering, difficult world, that it is such a wonderful way to navigate. And also to become a little more thoughtful about, I say that we're living life online now. And so, like, to become a little more thoughtful about what is that doing to us? How do we want to approach that? What's the right balance in our life? And also, I'm hoping some therapists read it and get some ideas about the challenges and pitfalls of remote therapy and how they can conduct it in a way that really works.
Right. Well, I hope you see everything that you want to see from the book.
One last thing. There are a lot of good stories in it. So actually, you know what? The thing that I want the most is read it. As a story, I think it's a really good story. There are a lot of stories in it.
Oh well, that we probably should have started with that.
Yeah, exactly. And that is the number one thing. It's just there are stories, and you know we all love to hear about other people's lives.
Absolutely, yeah, and that would be the trigger for me to pick it up without a doubt. Interesting stories. That's why I'm here. I love to hear interesting stories about interesting people.
Yeah.
And so thank you for coming here and sharing your thoughts and ideas and the book with us. And I hope people will check it out. And I hope you know we've made a difference to some people. I mean, that's all you can hope for, right? So
yeah, exactly. And thank you very much for having me. It's been a delightful conversation.
My pleasure. And the door's always open anytime you want to come back and get deep into like helping people by through me. I mean, I'd be happy to sit on your couch here virtually and let the world watch in and see if we can fix me. Anyway, Dr. Rosenblatt, thank you very much for coming. Thanks. And please come again. Thanks.
Bye. Thank you.
Therese Rosenblatt, Dr. Therese Rosenblatt, folks, and the book is called How Are You? Connection in a Virtual Age, A Therapist, A Pandemic, and Stories About Coping with Life. Sounds like a really fascinating book, and I hope you'll check it out. Tomorrow I have two shows, not the least of which is 8 p.m., the fabulous Christine Levine will be with me, comedian from Tucson, Arizona. I hope you will join me then. Till then, I'm Matt Knappo for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Have a great rest of your night. Bye for now. And write to me, info.